Morning, everyone. We'll start on a session on finite element method, coordinate systems. What are different coordinate systems used in finite element analysis? And also, we are going to discuss about different shape functions, maybe a linear, nonlinear, maybe a quadratic higher order shape functions. And we'll discuss what is the way we can derive those shape functions and kind of. So basically, we are going to discuss first of all, what does that coordinate system, how many coordinate system, and most important is in a natural coordinate system. This type of coordinate system is mostly used in all CAD analysis also. Also, it will be used in so many other places also. It's not only related to a finite element analysis, but it can be used to create a geometry in softwares like a PTC or kind of things. Also, it will be used for modeling purpose. So many have an applications for this. This will explore later stage. Then we'll look at what does that shape function means, and we'll try to derive a shape function for this all three cases. Okay. So basically, if you look into the coordinate system means if I take any point into the space, it has an altogether 6 degrees of freedom. So this is my x-axis, this is y-axis, and this is z-axis. These are the three translational motions. And then there will be a rotation of each axis, rotation about each axis, that is 3 theta, I can say, altogether 6 DOF system it is there. Means if I want to define any point into the space, it will have two things into this. One is, it's a spatial location, that is xy coordinates, xyz. Another one is an orientation, how it is oriented, how much it is an angle, whether it is rotated about this axis, how much it is rotated. All these will be defined by theta, and this will be translational degrees of freedom, will tell you about the locations, that is x, y, and z. It is okay. So in this case, when we are going to analyze any finite element analysis, so there will be a typical coordinate system is necessary, because whatever the problems we have seen it up till now, we are not dealt with in a coordinate system. We only analyze for a very small size kind of problems. But when you want to have a bigger size problem, maybe your element is more than 100 elements and kind of things, in that case, you need to mount in a coordinate system, and we need to represent all these elements with respect to certain reference location, and that reference location, how it is there. So that is nothing but a card as in a coordinate. And this coordinate system will have in three cases, three different types. One is a global coordinate system, which will be defined at a particular location. If I'm having this is my location and this is my model. This is a model I have modeled it, and this is my reference location, my x coordinate, y coordinate. What I can do, I can now create a vector for it. Okay. This is what a vector, which will represent x and y coordinates, and I can now define this. Means, what are the position of all these points, all these links, entire geometry is represented with respect to this. That's what it is called as in a global. Because it may contain a more than one element, maybe 100 element or kind of things, and each and every element and all these points are defined with respect to this. That's what it is called as in a global. It represents globally all elements. That's what it is called as in a global. Another one, if I take one of the elements separate, I will take it separately, and this is my one element, and I am going to mount on one coordinate system at a particular node, then it becomes a local coordinate system. Means, what are this coordinate system is represents its entire deformation, location, each and everything with respect to this locally defined coordinates. That's what it is called as a local coordinate system. Local coordinate system for each and every element will be separately defined. This is one, this is second, then I can have another one, okay, then I can have another one like this. Now we have one here, it is an x1, y1 coordinate system. Here it is an x2, y2 for second element, x3, y3 for third element, x4, y4 for fourth element. So these are the local coordinate system represented with respect to a single coordinate system, that is what in a global coordinate system. And third one is in a most important, as already I told you, that is natural coordinate. Natural coordinate system is typically a kind of an imaginary coordinate system, which cannot be shown into the picture or something. So this will be used to define entire your analysis in normalized fashion, in generalized fashion. We'll look that part in detail in that. So this is what on a global coordinate, this is my global coordinate system for 1D analysis. This is 1D means I am going to define only one degree of freedom. That's what it is called as a 1D analysis. Similar fashion, if I am going to do an a 2D analysis, like in a truss type of a problem or something. So in that case, this is my X and Y, two coordinates. That's what it is called as a 2D global coordinate. So what are the location of this point 2, point 3, point 4 is represented with respect to this coordinate. So that's what it is called as global. It is represented as a global. Or a single coordinate system represented into any of the single model global. And maybe for each and every element, there will be a multiple coordinate system like this. This is what on a local. This is an entire element. Spread within one between one and two nodes. Now you can just look at this is x, this is y, it is represented in this particular zone. So if I'm going to define anything beyond this point, it will not be allowed. That is what we call as a local. Okay. And we need to define this local. Reason for that, basically, when you are going to do any stress analysis of. So you want to know the stresses coming in this element 6. What you will do, you will bring, you will get all this global coordinate, deformation of each. And then we'll convert that into local coordinate. And you want to do the analysis of typical single element. Maybe you're going to determine stresses, maybe going to determine strength. In that case, what is that I need to know how much it is spread in that locally and what is the way I can do the analysis, all this stuff can be quite easily done using a global. So for that purpose, it is necessary. If you look into the natural coordinate system, okay, that is third one. A natural coordinate system is a coordinate system which permits specification of point within the element by set of what kind of an numbers? It is a dimensionless. Is a typical, keep in mind, this is a typically represented in dimension. And whose magnitude never exceeds its unit. Maybe it is varying from minus 1 to 1. What are this if I consider an element, bar element or something? I can have a displacement of this because ultimately all these coordinate systems, what is the objective of it? Objective is determine this field variables. Field variable in case of a stress analysis, we have a stress that is a displacement as in a field variable. If you are going to a thermal analysis, temperature as in a field variable. Like, so here, this is node number one and node number two. In coordinate system, it is assumed that maximum deformation of this node is a unity. That is what one. This node is having another one as a unity, maybe minus one or something. But it never exceeds beyond this one. That is what basically thing, and that is what it is called as natural. This is first thing, dimensionless number, that is minus one to one, and never your magnitude never exceeds beyond this particular number. So it is obtained. How it is obtained? In assigning weights to nodal coordinate. Nodal coordinate means I have on a nodes, maybe like this. I'm going to give a weightage to each and every node. We'll say it how to give the weightage. Maybe I'm going to give W1, W2, W3. This weightage is given, but this weightage will help us to define your elements in global way. Global means it can be used for my interdisciplinary coupling kind of an analysis.
that is weightages to each nodal coordinates in defining the coordinate of any point inside the limit. Hence, such system has a property. What is its property? Ith coordinate has a unit value at ith node I of the element and zero values at all others. So that is what I'm basically. And then use of this natural coordinate gives an advantage in assembling elemental properties like in a stiffness matrices kind of things. Maybe thermal conductivity matrices if you're going to do a thermal analysis. So in that case, it will be a much more helpful. Another one, most important, you might have gone through one integration type, that is a Gaussian quadrature, maybe numerical integration. In that case, also you may be remembering what are this a, b, x raised to 2 dx, this integration I want to compute. So in Gaussian quadrature, what we convert? We convert that integration into minus 1 to 1 and we conduct the integration. So this is what an integration will be much more to do an integration, because all this FEM does in a solution of differential equation. Differential equation, if you are going to get the solution of differential equation, means ultimately you need to take an integration of that with respect to what are the special. That is what an integration, and this is what an Gauss quadrature integration will be helpful in all these cases. Okay. So we'll now look at then a simple case, one bar element. In this bar element, natural coordinate of point P, any point P, that is L1 and L2. What are, if I assume a displacement of here it is in 1 and here I will assume it is 1, and what are the displacement of this will be nothing but a weightage due to node number 1 and node number 2. That is what, so that is on a simple case. So that's what this L1 and L2 are considered to be the natural coordinates of particular point into any point between these two nodes. Okay. So, how can I define this point? Point is now away from this x1, node number 1, by distance x minus x1, and from point 2 it is x2 minus x. This is my x. Okay. So, this is the nothing but my x1 and x2 are coordinates. Okay, from this side and this side, like this, coordinates of your nodes. And this total length of the element is L. L, this can be not represented with a capital L, but should be represented with small l. Okay. So, if you are going to give a weightage to each and every nodal coordinate, weightage to the nodal coordinates, total weightage at any point in the entire coordinate should be equal to L unity. Means I have an L1 weightage given to the node 1, and L2 weightage given to the node. And if I add these two, it should result into one all the time. So that is the basically first requirement in defining any system in natural. So first is that weightage is given at different points. I'll not say only for the nodal cases. Okay, we'll again continue with this. So basically, when we are going to do it, first condition in the natural coordinate is the weightage given to the individual node should sum to be equal to 1, sum of all. If I have three nodes, my equation becomes L1 plus L2 is second weightage, third is L3, which is equal to 1. If I have four nodes, L1, L2, so I can go on doing the sum of all the weightages equal to 1. This is what in the first condition in the
sir, awaaz yet nahi sir.
Okay, so this is what in a basically a L1, L2 are nothing but in a weightages for individual. If I sum up these two, result into 1. If I am having in a three nodes, just imagine I have in a three nodes, obviously weightage for individual node, that is L1, L2. L3 should be equal to 1. If I have an n number of nodes in my entire element, that will result into sum of all the weightages of individual nodes. So this is the first condition. Now I want to, because this is an imaginary coordinate system, so that is what on the first thing. Second thing, when you are going to determine a location of my point in the entire coordinate system, so this is what the formula I can use. Now, what is this? L1 is my weightage and x1 is my coordinate. Okay, I want to determine the coordinate of point P if I know this L1 and L2 coordinates. That is a coordinates of these two end points. So what is the way I can do it? I can have an x is in a coordinate of point P, which is nothing but a weightage of node number 1 and its coordinate. So this is 1 plus weightage of node number 2 and its coordinate. So this is what the way you can determine a coordinate of coordinate system. That is coordinate of any point into the natural. If I have three nodes in this, so my equation becomes x, weightage of first coordinate, then its coordinate, weightage of second coordinate and its coordinate, then weightage of third coordinate and its coordinate, like this. So same is concept is applicable for both the cases, maybe in a 1D analysis, 2D analysis, 3D analysis, or any kind of analysis. That is what. So now we'll look at this particular thing. We will now derive the equations, how to determine this L1, L2, L3. That is what I'm basically. I can't take these numbers arbitrarily, because these numbers depends on these two basic equations, L1 plus L2 is equal to 1 and L1 x1 plus L2 x. Now, can I write these equations like this? So from this, I can get an equation L1 plus L2 is equal to 1. That is one thing. So this from second equation, I can have an L1 x1 plus L2 x2 is equal to x. So I can now represent these two equations in matrix form. Ultimately, you want to determine L1 over the entire element. So in that case, what I can do is L1 and L2. So I can now take this matrix to this side. Okay. That is what an inverse of this. Inverse of this x. Okay. So if I am going to determine the inverse of this, so this is nothing but an adjunct method to determine the adjunct method. I can have an A inverse is equal to determinant of A, 1 upon determinant of A, that is A transpose. So that is what basically a method by which we can determine inverse of any matrix, that is a adjunct method. So this method is applied here. So that is a determinant of this particular loop. This particular matrix is 1 into x2 minus 1 into x1, which gives me x2 minus x1. This is my determinant of this. So I can get this here, it is determinant. Now transpose, and that is what in a process you can do. And then not only transpose, but it is in a something inverse transpose. So I can get this transpose here, and I can substitute, I will get an L1, L2 will be represented by finally by after derivations and that. So x2 and minus x1 is nothing but a total length of my element. I can substitute this length, and x2 minus x will come here, x minus x1 will come here, and this. So this is nothing but typically a element, that is this is L1, L2 I got, and now variation of L1 and L2 can be plotted. So what is the way it is plotted? It is plotted like this. So this is my node number 1. Okay. So this is node number 1 having an unit displacement. For L1, it will show the variation. At node number 2, it will be 0. At this is 1. So this is for L1 case. So if I look at the L2 case, L2 at this node number one, because L2 I defined a node number two. So that's what L2 will have an identity at node number two. That is what this one here. And for another node, I will have an zero. So that is what the way can be defined. That is variation of L1 and L2. You can just look at here. L1 is node one at node number one and zero at a node number two. And in node number two, in case of node number two, this L1 is 1 at this location and 0 at node 1. That is what it can be seen. And what are the variation? Because there are only two points to be joined, it will be nonlinear. That is a simple case. Okay? So, most of the time, what is to be done? You need to conduct an integral. That is what I mean. Do it. So for this integration, there is a closed form integration over the entire domain. How from where it comes? Because you have a weightage for here it is an L1 and here it is an L2. So both this, I want to do all this analysis. So that's what I can have on a coordinate here x1, here it is an x2, integration from x1 to x2. And in L1 raised to P, L2 raised to P, Q, so I can have integration. So there will be a certain exam problems like determine the integration. Only one L1 is there, having an integration to be done from 0 to 1. So what I can do it here, P is equal to 2, Q is equal to 0, and I can have an integration. That is, here I can substitute into this formula, I'll get the integration and I'll get the answer as an L by 3, that is L by 3. So this is my answer. Similar fashion, if I have another integration, that is L1, L2, both the terms, I have P is 3, Q is 1 here, I can substitute here into this and I'll get the integration as L upon 20. Likewise, you can go on doing this in natural coordinate in one dimensional. Okay. So there is one way to represent this natural coordinate. This we have just now we seen in L1 and determining weightage of this individual, that is L1 and L2. Sometimes in some books you can find N1, N2 or something. So that is what nothing but in a different notation you can find in different books. So keep in mind that notation will not serve the purpose. What it serves the purpose? Concept it serves. Okay. So here it is represented with the letter is a zeta. This is a letter typically represented globally that zeta is considered to be a natural coordinate for a zeta for one dimensional. For two dimensional, it is zeta and eta will be. And for three dimensional, zeta, eta and maybe gamma it is called. So these are the way it is represented. For one dimensional, it is only zeta. This is for 1D, this is for 2D, and this is for 3D. Okay. So in one dimensional problem, only typical coordinate, natural coordinate is zeta. That is zeta for any point. And zeta can be represented. So that is what on a P and C, these are the points. Okay. And you know that x1 and x2 coordinates are there for nodes. And this is nothing but L by 2. Theta is represented with C is equal to this. And this can be varying from this point onward to this point. This is what an imaginary point. Okay. So where P is in a point, okay, and C is in a center point of the nodes. This is the center point of the node. 1 and 2. Relationship between the natural coordinate and Cartesian coordinate is represented by this equation. Okay, so that is what an is this equation. This is nothing but an equation. Okay. So here I can now start writing this PC zeta is equal to this, L is length of the element x2 minus x1. Now I can substitute into this and go on simplifying. I will get a final equation. So this is what an equation. And finally, I can again simplify more and I will get an L by 2 into bracket 1 plus zeta, which is equal to x minus x1. So this is nothing but a conversion from x coordinate to the zeta coordinate. Okay, it's kind of a mapping you are getting. Just mapping means I will tell you. I have an sum here, it is in two nodes. This is represented in x coordinate. I want to have another coordinate system which is having a representation of g. So there, whenever I am going to convert this into this, there will be a certain element or transformation, I can say. So that transformation will convert x into zeta, and I can inverse it, I will get a zeta into x. That is one. And what are this relation tells you about that conversion? That's it. Nothing else. Okay. So here it may be noted that node number 1 at x equal to 1. If I put this into the x equal to x1, so x into x1 means this will become 0 and I will get a value of g is equal to minus 1. If I put into the node number 2, I will get a x equal to x2. I will substitute x2 minus x1 becomes L, and here it becomes an 1. Right. So that is what the way you can now get this relationship. So we can now have an integration of this kind of an integral. This is what a formula you got. You need to do an integration with the coordinate zeta. Okay. So obviously it is represented. This part is represented into zeta. To be either converted into this x and x1 to be converted into zeta, or zeta is to be converted into x1. So obviously here it is an integration is x1 and it reaches to the next. Okay. So I need to convert that into minus 1 to 1, because your integration is somewhere, maybe here it is an x1 and here x2. This is what an integration, not I will say it is in a function, and this is my x. So this is to be converted into some kind of a function, that is a zeta, which is from minus 1. This is a plus 1 and this is my minus 1. Okay. So this, whatever this is to be converted into this particular function, and that is what a conversion will be done by this. That is what this equation, if I take a derivative of this, what will happen? This will become 0 and 1 by 2 zeta minus dx. Okay. So this dx, x1 is a constant because it is coordinate. So I can now take this. Here it is. I can just show you here. Take a derivative of this d by g d zeta, and here it is take a d by dx. So here you will get this becomes 0, and then I have a zeta which is equal to dx, but here 1 by 2 I need to take it. That's what it will come to be 1 by 2. So that is 1 9, it is L. L by 2 d. So dx becomes 2 by L d. So here I can now substitute into this and I can go on integrating, and I will get this. I can use this formula directly to this and I can solve. So that is what the way you can solve this. So we'll now look at how to do it into 2D. X coordinate, there is a two coordinate x as well as y coordinate. So that is, first is, I have a three noded element, node number 1, node number 2, and node number 3. So in this case, I am going to give the weightage for node number 1, L1. Here I am going to give the weightage to L2, and here I am going to give weightage to L3. So first rule is that I have a sum of all the weightages over the entire node. So that is L1 plus L2 plus L3 is equal to. So that is one. So another one, that is, next I want to determine the coordinates, that is x coordinate, or any point into this entire triangular element. So in that case, what I have, this is my x coordinate and this is y coordinate. So I want to determine this x in terms of an weightage. So what is the way I can do it? L1 x1 plus L2 x2 plus L3. So this is my second equation. This is my first equation. This is my second equation. Similarly, I want to determine the y coordinate. This is my x and this is my y coordinate. What way I can do it? Same way you can apply the principle here. L1 y1 here, not x1. L2 y2 here. And L3 y3 here. And I will get a third equation. Now these are the equations to be put into the matrix. So, same procedure it is to be applied, which we applied in one dimensional. So, L1, L2, L3, and I can put this into one matrix. So, ultimately, you want to determine L1, L2, L3. So, we will see it in the next slide. So, how can I determine? Already, we can use an adjunct matrix to determine inverse of it, and I can put this. So, L1, L2, I can take it into one side and this matrix is to be taken into the right side. So, that way I can put this inverse and it can, that this is what an inverse I will get. So, whenever you are going to do an inverse, okay, so we are going to determine the determinant of that. Determinant of that. If you taken a determinant of this matrix, it is observed it is equal to the twice the area of the your triangle. The area of the triangle we are determining and that triangle area is nothing but twice of this particular determinant. So we want to prove it, how it works because what am I? Proof. Determinant, you can go on determining determinant. Minus this. This is what am I determinant? 1 into x2 x2 y3 minus x3 y2 okay minus 1 this I need to take this is 1 this I need to take so that is x1 y3 minus x3 y1 plus 1 into these 1, 2, 3. So obviously x1 y2 minus y1 x2. First, same you can just observe here. So this is what an mat determinant we take. Okay. Now we have an coordinates for each points that is a vertices of mat. This. So ultimately area of the entire triangle of this ABC is nothing but an area of A then D okay A to D then E and then C. This is one area okay this is one area then second area is that this is second area is CE. So this is one area, okay. Then second area is this, okay. This is my second area. Now I can quite easily delete this much area, okay, and I'll get the entire area of the triangle. That is what AD. So I can have one with this particular triangle area, and that is what in a triangle equation. This is another equation. Third. I can quite easily. This is what in a parallelogram, and I can get the integration. I can get the area. Now I can put this AD. AD is nothing but x1, okay, y1, and then CE is my y3. CE is my y3. Like this, I can go on substituting, and ultimately, after entire simplification, you'll get that 1 by 2 is nothing but my entire determinant. This is what the determinant of the matrix, which we determined here. So that is what the way you can see it. But whenever you are going to do a 2D analysis, it is observed, most important. In 1D analysis, zeta is considered to be one part, that is a natural coordinate. And then 2D analysis, that is what it is called as an area, because it deals with the area of this. Okay. Determinant is equal to 2 times the area of triangle ABC, that is 2A. Now I can put this 2A into this, I can put the transpose and I can get the adjunct matrix. I can go on putting, simplifying it, A1, A2, all this I can go on determining, and ultimately our aim is to determine L1, L2. I got this L1, L2. Okay. So that is the way you have determined L1, L2, L3. After this L1, L2, L3, now you can put into this, A1 plus A, even all these formulas, and you will get 2A1 upon A1. This ultimately, you are going to convert the shape, that is L1, L2, L3, these are the weightages, are represented in terms of an area, that is in terms of an area. Area 1 is this, my area. This is my area 1. Area 2 is this much. This is my area. So it is a ratio of total area divided by these, the areas occupied due to this particular point into this triangle. Okay. If this particular point will divide this into three different areas. And if I join these points, that is even A, B, C. So these are nothing but an area. It is represents into an area. That's what it's called as an area. Okay. So where A1, A2, A3 are areas of subtriangles. These are the subtriangles we have seen. Okay. That is 1, 2, 3 at opposite to the 1, 2, 3. Hence, natural coordinates and triangles are also called as what? Area. Okay, keep in mind, these are called as an area, because L1 is represented with an A1 upon A, and L2 is represented with an A2 upon A, and L3 is represented with an A3 upon A. That is what. If I consider one of the area here, A1, this point on the edges of the L1, but what is the way I can do it? So I have only two areas, A2 and A3, and third area is 0. So obviously, A1 will become A, A2 is equal to A3, A3, these two will become 0, and I can now put it to this. So that is what the way you can represent 2D or 1D elements into natural coordinates. So here 1 by 2, so you can just go on looking at all these derivations in more detail. Okay. So now we'll see it, how to do an integration. This is what a closed form integration formula for triangular elements, that is L1, or L2, L3, P, Q, R, these are. Okay. Because it is previously here, you might have seen in theta coordinate, only one single coordinate. This was an A is represented. That L is nothing but an length coordinate. Here it is an area. So if you want to determine the integration of this over the area, now P is 1, Q is 1, R is 1. I can put all this and I will get this over the entire integration becomes A by 6. So same is here. This is another problem. This is my first problem and this is my second problem. That is L1, L2, LP is here 3. Q is 1, R is 0, I can substitute, I will get this entire integration A by 6. So then third problem is here, that is L1 square, L2 square, L3 square, L3 cube. Then P is 2, Q is 2, R is 3, and you can put into this formula, you will get the area A upon 7960. Okay. So these are the things we have planned for today's session. Okay. And from next lecture onward, we'll define in a particular shape function, either for two noded bar element, three noded bar element, and also maybe a triangle element. We'll try to derive that particular equations, which will deal with the